This video will introduce JDBC, Java Database Connectivity, which is a Java API that is part of the JVM and is used to access databases. Why include database calls in this course, one might ask? Well, first, it's an interesting case study of using a framework that communicates over TCP sockets, which JDBC does normally. But more importantly, we require database connectivity later on in the course when studying application servers. It's not much point in creating a server-side application that does not use a database. Okay, so that's why we're going to look at JDBC now. So I will not explain databases or SQL, the structured query language used to access a relational database. I suppose probably you have studied databases before. If you feel the need to look into SQL or databases, there are multiple tutorials on the web, and I've recommended some tutorials on the course web. So I will not cover that again here. Now instead, let's have a look at how to call a database using JDBC from a Java program. The red thing up here to the left is supposed to illustrate a program that we are writing. The black barrel down to the right is the database server, which is hosting our database. And the little black thing here is a TCP socket that the database server has opened. When a program, like my prog up here, wants to query the database to read or write or update or whatever the database, it is supposed to open a TCP connection to the database server's socket here and send commands to the database. And the green thing here is the network. So the database is running on one node in the network, and the rest, so far the rest is only my prog, is running on another node. While drawing the parts of the JDBC application here, I will also write a small sample program that uses these JDBC concepts. But first we have to start a database. So for this tutorial I will use the JavaDB, Derby. It's called both JavaDB and Derby, which is a very simple database not meant to be used for production, but for testing purposes. It's included in NetBeans IDE. You can use any database server you wish that has a JDBC driver. This NetBeans project that is in the GitHub includes drivers for MySQL and JavaDB. You can use another database as well if you wish, but then you have to load the driver. Okay, first let's start the database. Right click and start. So the database is running. You can see here it started. It has started and is ready to accept connections. Okay, then we must create the database. Create database. It can be called my sample database. JavaDB does not require us to have a username and a password, but certain applications do. So it's good practice. Well, besides, it's always good practice to have a username and a password, right? So let's have the fancy username JDBC and the same password. So the database is created. Let's see. It is there, right? And we can connect to it. So now there is a connection, which is here. The user is JDBC, and there are no tables in the database. It's empty. So now back to this image. The thing is, in our program, the red thing, which is the basic JDBC program here, we need to call the database down to the right. So we could, of course, open our own TCP socket here, establish our own TCP connection, connect to the database socket and send the commands relevant for the database. But we don't know the database server's protocol, and each database server has their own specific protocol. So it would really be a nightmare. There's a lot of low-level coding handling sockets and the database server's internal protocol. So we will not do that. It's never a good idea. Instead, we will use JDBC. Now I'm going to write a lot of blue things, and all the blue things belong to JDBC. First of all, we need the JDBC driver. Note that the driver is black. It is written by the database server vendor and knows how to communicate with the database server. So it's the driver that will open the TCP socket and communicate with the database server. We download the driver from the database server vendor. And the driver is a set of classes that can communicate with the database, but that has an interface which complies to the JDBC standards. So the driver will implement an interface. The interface driver that is part of the JDBC API. So the JDBC classes and interfaces are located in the Java SQL package. The first thing to do then in our program is to load the driver. So to load the driver, we first must make sure that the driver is on the class path. Actually, there is no JDBC driver included in the JVM, so we have to download the driver from the database vendor. And since this is a Maven project, I have entered a dependency in the POM. So this dependency here tells Maven to download the jar that contains the JavaDB JDBC driver. So that's all you need to get the driver. And if you download this code from the course GitHub, then you get this POM that already includes this dependency. So then you have the Derby JDBC driver. So then we load the driver by calling class.forName and then the driver name. And the name of the Derby JDBC driver class is this, org apache derby jdbc client xa data source. So besides making sure it's available on the class path, you also have to know the class name to be able to load it. This line can throw the class not found exception if it cannot find this class on the class path. What to do? Let's add a try catch. And let's not log to any logger, but print to system out instead. So never leave a catch block empty, right? Always make sure that we are informed if the exception is thrown. Now let's try to understand this line here, the class.forName call. What does it do? Well, forName is a static method in the class JavaLang class. And what it does is to load this file, clientxadatasource.class, into the JVM. It creates an internal representation of this class in the JVM. It reads the class file from the file system and creates a representation of it in the JVM. So the first thing we must do in our program is to ask the driver for a connection to the database. So a connection is like a session to the database. So the connection is the heavyweight object that actually established the TCP connection. It takes time to create a connection object. You should not discard a connection object once you have it, but instead try to reuse the same connection for multiple SQL statements. Now let's try to get the connection from the driver. So to do that, we need to use the JDBC class driver manager. So driver manager is our program's entry point to JDBC, and we will ask it for a connection by calling its method getConnection and passing in a URL which describes the database. And the format of this URL will soon be clear when we go to the sample code in the basic JDBC program. This call to getConnection will return a connection object. So remember that the connection is the session with the database that should be used for all interaction with the database. It can be used to create a statement that can be sent to the database to perform a query or update the state in the database. It can be used to retrieve metadata about the data in the database or about the data that was found during a search to the database. And it can be used for transaction management. By default, each SQL statement is executed in its own transaction, which commits or rolls back immediately after the statement is executed. But we can turn this off and instead configure JDBC to group several SQL statements in the same transaction. However, we will not do that now, but instead further on in the course, both in the next video on OR mapping and later when using application servers. So now let's see how this call to get connection works in the program. But in the program, we ask the driver manager for the connection and pass the URL. So this string should be the URL. And what is the format of the URL? Well, we must know also that it's different for different databases. So the method getConnection also throws an exception. So let's add a catch clause for that one as well. It's not like that, but let's use the multi-catch syntax, since we will do the same for all exceptions. Right, so this is the format of the URL for a Derby database. JDBC URLs also always starts with the protocol JDBC, then comes sub-protocol identifying the database vendor, then comes the location of the database server. It's running on localhost, and the default port for Derby database is 1527, and then the name of the database. Okay, so this URL identifies our database. And how does this actually work? How can this line and this line together result in us getting a connection? And in particular, how can driver manager know that this class exists? But first let's test run it to see that it works so far. So let's run this program. It did not work. The database was not found. Okay, did we spell it correctly? It should have uppercase M. Shift F6 is run file in NetBeans. Connection authentication failure. Right, because we have not specified username and password. Those are parameters of the getConnection method, and remember both username and password was JDBC. Let's run it again. Yes, now it works. So back to the question, what actually happens here? So the thing is that the class.forName method makes the JVM load the client xadatasource.class file into the JVM and create a representation of this class. And the thing is that when a class is loaded into the JVM, also its static initializers are executed. So what's a static initializer? Well, the thing is that any Java class can have such a block, just a set of parentheses like this. See, it's legal code, which is like an anonymous constructor, you could say. And we can make it static. So now we have like a static constructor. Code here on line 11. In the static initializer will be executed when the class file is loaded. And the thing is that every JDBC driver here calls the driver manager, which has some method for registering a driver. Yeah, here it is. So the driver does this. When class.forName is executed, this method is called, and the driver registers itself with the driver manager. It should not be here, it's done in by the driver. And then when we call getConnection, driver manager will ask all its registered drivers, can you handle this URL? Can you handle this URL? So each driver will get the opportunity to look at the URL and decide if that particular driver can handle that URL. And I guess they will look at the sub-protocol. The Derby driver will say it can handle URLs with the Derby sub-protocol. So that way the Derby driver client xadatasource will create a connection and return it. So the driver manager has forwarded this getConnection request to the driver that was loaded here and then returns the connection. So let's save it in the connection object. There. Okay, so now our program has a reference to the connection object. And we can use that reference to create a statement, which can be used to send SQL statements to the database. So that is done with the method createStatement, which will return a statement object. Let's order things a bit. The first thing that happened was to load the driver. The second was to retrieve the connection from the driver manager. And now we are doing the third, which is to create the statement object. So then we have the statement object, and then we can use that object to send a query to the database. This first statement that we're executing will be an update. Actually, it will be SQL code to create a table, because currently there is no table in the database. The database is completely empty, so we cannot do anything with it. Therefore, we execute an update. And we will pass some SQL string to create the table. So this was the fourth thing. Okay, so this diagram now basically illustrates everything, all the concepts related to the JDBC API. Load the driver, get the connection from the driver manager, get the statement from the connection, and execute SQL using that statement. So the statement object is like an envelope for SQL code. There are a few more things which we will soon see in the program we are writing. So now let's do this in the code. First, get the statement from the connection object. And then use that statement to execute an update that creates the table in the database. So the SQL string for creating a table can be like this. We create a table that is called person, that has a column name, which is a string of max length 32 characters, which is the primary key. The person has a phone number, which is also a string of length, maximum length 12, and the person has an age, which is an integer. When executing this, there should appear such a table. Let's have a look first at the database. My sample there. The user was JDBC. There is currently no table. Okay, we run this program. Program has executed. Now there is the person table, and it has the columns name, phone, and age. Okay, but there is of course no data. It is empty. But unfortunately there is a problem. If we execute this program again, we get an exception, and that's because now we are trying to create a table person that already exists in the database. So before creating the table, we should check if it exists. Let's try to do that, and it's good because that allows us to introduce the last two concepts of the JDBC API. First, the database metadata class, which contains metadata, like for example which tables there are. So we're going to use that one to check if there already is a person table in the database. And we can get a database metadata object from the connection by calling the getMetadata method. We have already seen that we can get metadata from the connection. The last class is the result set. So the result set is a table-like structure which contains data that was retrieved either from the database metadata object or, more commonly, by sending an SQL select statement to the database. So it holds kind of table with columns, where each column is a particular data and each row is a particular instance. Let's say that we have searched for persons, for example, then we have the columns as the same as in the table: name, age, phone, and so on. And each row represents one individual person, one entry from the database, just like a database table. And we can get a similar result set from the database metadata object, for example, containing data about existing tables, which we soon will do. Before executing the statement to create the table, let's check if the table exists. So first we retrieve the database metadata object from the connection. There, and then we query the metadata for tables. So the metadata contains a lot of information about the database, but now we're only interested in tables. So let's query for existing tables. And the result will be returned as a result set. We can see here that there are loads of different string parameters to this method, which are different ways to narrow the search, like search criteria. But we'll just specify null for all of them, which is the wildcard, meaning we will simply get information about all tables in the database. There. Now we have to check if there is a row in this result set which contains information about the table called person, which means we must extract the table names from this result set. This is the Java doc for the database metadata, and in particular the method getTables. And we can see that the third column is the table name. So we must extract the values of the third column on all rows in this result set. Let's iterate over this result set. The next method in the result set advances the cursor to the next row in the result set. The result set maintains an internal cursor, that is, initially when the result set is retrieved here or from a select statement, the cursor is above the first row. So first calling next advances the cursor to the first row. And whenever we call next, well, next will return true if there is a next row and false if there is not. So this while loop will simply iterate through the entire result set. We should check if there exists a table called person. So first we retrieve the value of the third column, which was the table name. So call the method of the appropriate type and specify the appropriate column. So now table name contains the name of the table represented on the current row in the result set. So let's see if it is the person table. Okay, so now we are typing person for the second time. As experienced programmers, we know that we should not repeat data, no duplicated data, no hard-coded data. So let's define a constant for that one. We should of course do the same for the column names, but let's stick to this for now. Okay, so now we're sure to use the same table name both here and in the comparison we're about to do here. Then what? Well, actually, this is becoming a bit wrong way round. We will have to introduce flags and stuff, and the program is already becoming quite long, so let's instead move this to another method, the private method, and it will be easier. Everything here, in fact. Refactor. Introduce method, which can be called create table. Yeah. In the create table method, we first will want to check if the table already exists, which are these lines. So again, introduce method, and let's call it table exists. Now we just return true here if. Oh, it must be Boolean. If we find the table with the name person. If we loop through the entire result set without finding such a table, we return false. The table does not exist. So now, up in create table, we can write if table exists, no, if not table exists, then create the table there. Okay, so now the program should work, whether the table exists or not. Let's first try to run it now that the table does exist. We see the table is there. Refresh to make sure. Yeah, it's there, the table. We run the program. Okay, so placing a breakpoint on this line and running the program in the debugger. Here on this line, we see the table names that they are found. We can see the table names changing here as we iterate over the result set. And first of all, we see that there are loads of tables we did not create that are always existing in the database. When we finally arrive at the person table, we see that it's in uppercase letters. Okay, that was the problem. So let's instead use here equals ignore case, like that, and run the program again. So now it works. No errors, and the table is still there. Okay, so now let's delete the table. Now there is no table, and we run the program. And now the table appears. Now it's time to do something with the database. So I've added two lines here. These two lines that insert data into the database. Again, we call execute update. First create a statement here, then use that statement to execute an update, change the state of the database by executing insert statements. So insert into the table name person, and we insert the values Stina, which was the name of the person, the first column, this, which is the phone, the second column, and this, which is the age, the third column. So Stina, that is 43 years old and has this phone number, and then insert Olle, who is 12 years old and has this phone number. And note, by the way, that I create new statements. Statement is a lightweight object that we can create many times, but the connection is the heavyweight object. When we create a connection, we establish a TCP connection, so we should reuse the same connection, and we do. Use that connection here, and then again here. Let's run this program. Great, so then let's look at the database. So now the two persons are there, Stina and Olle. Then I wrote a method down here that lists the database content. It's called list all rows, and also use the same connection. So again, create a statement. Use it this time to not to execute an update, but a query that is searching the database. And select asterisk all rows from the table person, so it will select all rows from the table person and return those in a result set, which is a table of those rows. So we loop through that result set here and print each line. First name, and then the value of the name, which was the first column. It's this one here, and it's a string. And then phone, the value of the phone column, which was the second, and it's also a string. Age, and the value of the age column, that was the third one and is an int. Right, so let's call this method and run the program again. Right, and of course we get an exception because we're trying to insert rows that already exist. We're trying to insert the same rows again, so there will be a duplicate primary key, which is not okay. So actually, this is not a very well designed database. We cannot have two persons with the same name. Anyway, let's remove those two. There. And then run the program again. So now we expect it to print the rows Stina and Olle. And it did. So here are those two rows. Okay, let's also delete. So this should delete the row Stina, and then again list all rows. Okay, so then first we should print both rows, and then just Olle. First let's remove them. And run the program. Yes, first both are listed, and then just Olle. That's fine. There's one concept still left to look at, and that is prepared statements. First, let's have a look at these statements we have used so far, which are not prepared, which means whenever the statement is executed, we send the actual string to the driver. This means the driver will have to compile the SQL statements again and again, even if they are identical, which is time consuming. To avoid that, we can use a prepared statement. Driver will only have to compile the SQL statement once, and then can reduce the same code, just change the values, the parameters. So I created a method, prepare statements, that creates prepared statements. Let's have a look at the insert statement, for example. So now we call prepare statement instead of create statement in the connection object. And that method will return an object of the class prepared statement. So this thing here is declared as a field in the class up here. So it's an object of class prepare statement. Okay, so the SQL code is the same, only the actual values are now replaced by question marks, which is parameters. So when executing this statement, we must set the values of the parameters. And then I have in the same way created a prepared statement that selects all rows, and a prepared statement that deletes a certain row. And those are the statements we are using. So now let's exchange these lines for prepared statements instead. Okay, but first let's repeat the advantages of prepared statements. It is faster if we use the same statement multiple times. Because it's slower the first time when the database has to do all the compilation and also store the statement in the database. But after that, it is faster to execute the prepared statement because there's no need to recompile it again. On the other hand, there is no guarantee that the driver supports pre-compilation. Might be that it actually, even though we're using a prepared statement and things work fine, it might be that it actually compiles the statement from scratch each time. So we have to read the documentation to see if the driver supports pre-compilation. Okay, but there's another advantage as well, and that is that using a prepared statement we avoid the risk of SQL injection. Without going too deeply into SQL injection attacks, I'll just say that the only thing that can be changed when executing a prepared statement is the value. There's no possibility to change the actual SQL content. But on the other hand, using an ordinary statement, the SQL is just a string. So if a malicious user somehow manages to insert SQL code instead of a parameter when the code is executed, outcome of the entire statement can be changed. Okay, so the advantages of prepared statements are execution speed and security. Now let's use the prepared statements. First, let's set the parameters. Okay, so the first parameter, parameter 1, is the name of the person. First is the name. First column is name. So we set the first person's name to Stina. So create person statement is the prepared statement we just prepared. And then we set the phone number, which is also a string, column 2, and Stina's phone number was this. Then we set the age, which was an int, and it was 43 there. And then we execute the statement there. So now we have replaced this first. And then we do the same again for the second, Olle. So now I have added the execution of the prepared statement to introduce Olle as well. So we set the parameter values first, execute the statement, set again other parameter values, execute the statement. Then let's change the list and deletion as well. So now I have changed also the delete person statement here. Set the first parameter to Stina. We want to delete the person Stina. Then we must execute it as well. And then in the list all rows method, I have also changed to execute the prepared statement, find all person statement. Okay, so now let's run it again using the prepared statements. First, let's check that it is empty. It's not. Remove Olle. Again, run the program. Never called the prepared statements method. So the prepared statements were never created. Let's call it here. And now let's try again. Yeah, now it worked. Okay, so now we have covered all the major JDBC concepts.